Welcome back, Witchlings. Previously, we discussed the ways in which radioisotopes distributed themselves across the globe, in addition to how a greenhouse gas functions at the atomic level. Today, we'll be analyzing a new radioisotope a bit more closely to unlock a new forensic tool to help us in understanding climate change. The isotope in question is regularly used to date organic materials. It is carbon-14, a radioisotope with a half-life of 5,730, plus or minus 40, years. Nicknamed radiocarbon, it decays through emission of an electron and an electron antineutrino and results in nitrogen-14. This particular isotope of carbon occurs only in trace amounts, as it's only produced in the upper layers of the troposphere and in the stratosphere. That's approximately 8 to 60 kilometers off the surface of the Earth. This is where neutrons in thermal equilibrium with their surroundings tend to be found most often. They are regularly absorbed by various atomic nuclei. Nitrogen-14 is included in those elements. It absorbs a neutron via neutron capture and results in carbon-14 as well as a proton. Additionally, it can be created by other neutron capture reactions, such as the ones that happened whenever we were testing nuclear weapons in our atmosphere. We nearly doubled the amount of carbon-14 in our atmosphere during the Cold War. It resulted in radiocarbon dating methods needing to be recalibrated for dates falling after 1950 in the current era. However, it has allowed for interesting study elsewhere. The bomb spike appears in tree rings around the world. It's also a medical tracer within every human being. It has allowed us to uncover how neurons renew and how tendons heal. It should stand to reason, then, that materials buried deep within the Earth's crust would be unaffected by the atmospheric tests. Moreover, it should be understandable that the further back one goes into the Earth's crust, the less likely they would be to find carbon-14. After all, the terrestrial carbon that was captured by plants has long since decayed. As we reach back to harness the power of ancient plants to feed our energy machine, we should keep in mind that these organisms had a hunger for a particular isotope. Plants often prefer carbon-12 to the other three isotopes because it is the lightest of them. When we burn them in the present day, this shows up in any air sample that we take. There are two particular ratios that are examined in these air quality checks. As we burn fossil fuels, we are mainly increasing the amount of carbon-12 and carbon-13 in the atmosphere. Remember, most of the carbon-14 has long since decayed away. However, because of organic life's affinity for carbon-12, more of those atoms would be put into the atmosphere. This would be apparent in the ratio of carbon-13 to carbon-12 atoms. If carbon-12-rich fossil fuels are to blame, we would see a negative correlation in this ratio, as the increasing denominator would result in a smaller output every iteration. This is exactly what we see in atmospheric samples. One could also view the reciprocal of the ratio, putting carbon-12 on top, and that would result in a positive correlation, indicating that more carbon-12 is being put into the atmosphere than carbon-13. We can also examine the effect that fossil fuels have on carbon-14 in the atmosphere. First described in 1957 by Dr. Hans Suess, there is a crowding out effect of carbon-14 as carbon-13 is admixed into the atmosphere. Due to the massive amount of carbon-13 that fossil fuels are putting into the atmosphere, in any given place on Earth, there are fewer carbon-14 molecules that can be measured in any given air sample. While this effect is highly dependent on pollution levels, it is still an observable way to see the impact that we've made. As of yesterday, we were at 404.16 parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is 104.16 parts per million above the highest ever CO2 level in the last 800,000 years. And that is the extent of the current relevant climate data. Until next time, stay safe and know that you are incredible. If you'd like to help me in my endeavor of making more things for your viewing pleasure, please consider checking out my Patreon. I appreciate you watching. Thanks. Bye.